19. But before we decide on the mode of therapy, it's very important that we understand the pathology of the disease. And like all my colleagues, the other panelists have spoken, they have discussed in depth what is this that the infection causes. So we have understood that there is something called a cytokine storm, which results in hypotension, vasodilatation, ARDS, and pulmonary edema. We also realize that there is an abnormal activation of the coagulation process, results in thrombi in the circulation and tissue hypoperfusion. There is an abnormal inflammatory response resulting in pulmonary edema and ARDS. And at the same time, endothelial activation contributes to the pathology of the disease. So having understood the pathology of the disease, we now discuss what are the treatment options available. Again, like everybody has shared, it's by and large supportive therapy. We know that there are antiviral therapy, there is anti-malarial, role of steroids, and of course, interleukin-6 inhibitors, which we talked about just now. Now, what is the role of convalescent plasma therapy? As we understand, right now, it is only an experimental role. And the basis behind this is immunological. Now, when we talk about convalescent plasma therapy, all of us should remember that the antibody that is there in the patient who is recovering from the disease, it's a passive administration of antibody from somebody who is recovering. And when we fractionate blood products, we get hyperimmune globulin, monoclonal antibodies, and vaccines. And these are meant to give durable therapeutic options. And of course, in the context of COVID-19, they are not yet available. And that is why human plasma is the only therapeutic strategy that is available in an experimental option at this point of time. So when we talk about immune plasma collected from individuals, what is its role? Its role, as I discussed earlier, is only a short-term benefit. It can prevent infection or it can blunt clinical severity in those who have been recently exposed to the pathogen. Passive antibody therapy is most effective when administered prophylactically or even used early after the onset of symptoms. The clinical benefit, the radiological resolution, reduction in viral load, and improved survival are some of these aspects that have been documented in literature. Globally, yes, we have several blood centers that have an excellent infrastructure to undertake plasma collections and also build up an inventory to meet the growing demand. There are, of course, challenges. Challenges, logistical issues of collection, transfusion. Besides this, it's not yet under the regulatory purview. So it's very important that we choose donors appropriately. So the donor eligibility criteria, donor recruitment should be very stringent so that there is no misuse and appropriate use is being taken care of. Now, when we talk about the role of convalescent plasma, as I just discussed, there are a range of indications. I mentioned that it can be used prophylactically or also in patients who are already suffering from the disease. It's also important to look at the patient population, age, associated comorbid diseases, and so on, which is definitely going to influence the way an individual responds to this treatment. We did discuss a lot about the role of antibody, and therefore I'm not going to talk much about it at this point of time. Now, besides passive immunity, are there other benefits? Is something that we should keep in mind. It's patients are also going to develop polyclonal antibodies that are present in the convalescent plasma, and this is going to help in those individuals who have humoral immune deficiencies. Besides this, because plasma is rich in clotting factors, it can help in managing hemorrhagic diathesis like we see in other viral infections and to a limited extent, maybe in COVID-19 infection. So this flowchart is essentially going to show us what are the different sources of plasma. One is whole blood. So can we use whole blood to treat these patients? It's a question. But now, today, in a world where we are almost 100% component therapy, most centers will resort to using plasma rather than whole blood. How do we get this plasma? Plasma can be collected from a donor's blood, where you collect about 450 ml of blood and separate from that 450 ml, 200 ml of plasma. But a more effective use is collecting plasma by apheresis, where you only use the collect plasma and return the red cells and platelets back into the donor circulation. So this is called apheresis, where we selectively remove one particular product. So plasma apheresis is the best option in this situation. Of course, component therapy in centers who do not have a facility for apheresis, can they still give convalescent plasma? Yes, they can collect whole blood, separate the blood into components and use the plasma for treatment. So you're going to ask me one important question at this stage. What happens to the donor's red cells? So is this red cell going to be of use to anybody? I'm afraid not, because you've collected red cell from somebody who has recently recovered from a viral infection, and therefore it will not fulfill the qualifications of donor eligibility for preparing red cells. So it cannot be like a healthy individual's red cells, and therefore that cannot be used. So even in a center where apheresis facility is not available and somebody badly needs to give plasma, one could consider it as a last option. So I spoke about convalescent whole blood. Yes, in those days, maybe a century ago, when component therapy was not yet there, convalescent whole blood was given during Ebola virus outbreak. But today, we would prefer plasma therapy because it ensures larger volume collection, more frequent donations, and it does not cause unnecessary anemia in the donor. There are several benefits of plasma therapy. One is to remove the inflammatory cytokine. Two is to stabilize the endothelial membrane, and very importantly, reset the hypercoagulable state. Another important factor is that the same donor can go through multiple cycles of plasma apheresis procedure and therefore become a repeated donor for this patient, for any patient. Now, how do these antibodies act? These antibodies can bind to the pathogen. You saw the diagram in the previous lecture that was given, where it causes neutralization and inhibits the infectivity of the organism. Now, besides binding to the pathogen, it can also cause complement activation, antibody-dependent cellular cytotoxicity, and phagocytosis. We also know that there are several non-neutralizing antibodies that can bind to the pathogen and contribute to the enhanced recovery of these patients. Now, if somebody wants to facilitate convalescent plasma therapy, how does one go about it? Now, the first thing that we could consider is an emergency use. Madam briefly spoke about investigation new drug, the IND application. So one could approach this mechanism of having to access convalescent plasma therapy for a patient as an emergency. Now, this allows a provider to apply for compassionate use in an individual patient who has life-threatening disease and there are no other options available. This guidance does not allow for prophylaxis. The minimal requirements enable those requests to be expedited. And this is what happened to one such situation in our country, where they explored this as a last option and we got to hear that the patient has recovered. Now, what is the second modality that we could resort? That is to apply for a research, like a part of a clinical trial, which any organization can do. The third thing is a government-led initiative. That is what has currently happened in India, where ICMR has come out with a protocol, and this facilitates, you can get a large number of institutions to participate under this protocol, and therefore you can get extensive data which can be used for future studies. So if you're looking at a clinical trial, it starts with an institutional ethical committee approval. It's very important to register in the clinical trial registry. And of course, the DCGI approval is mandatory. Now, when we talk about donors, who is eligible to donate? Everybody who has had COVID-19 in the past, can they donate, is a question. Definitely, there are some criteria. So those who are aged above 18, and the age requirements are as per the Drugs and Cosmetics Act. So one has to fulfill the regular criteria of blood donation. Male donors, definitely yes, but female donors, it's important that if they are multiparous, we should remember that the chances of them acquiring anti-HLA antibodies are very high. Therefore, it's preferred to have a nulliparous woman. But if you want to choose a multiparous lady, we have to demonstrate the absence of anti-HLA antibodies. So prior diagnosis of COVID-19 documented by RT-PCR with symptomatic disease, complete resolution at least 28 days prior to donation, or complete resolution of symptoms at least 14 days prior to donation with two negative RT-PCR tests from nasopharyngeal swab collected at least 24 hours apart. So these are the minimum criteria. They should have had a past history of COVID. They should have been RT-PCR positive. They should have had complete resolution of symptoms. And we should have two negative RT-PCR tests for COVID-19, 24 hours apart, after 14 days of resolution, in order to become eligible to donate plasma. Please note that the viral shedding in survivors have been documented as long as 37 days. And that is why it becomes mandatory that they have to be tested and shown that they are RT-PCR negative. And with regard to the appearance of antibodies, it was beautifully illustrated in the graphic representation in the session on antibodies, where we understood that IgM and IgA antibody occur, develop very early, as early as day 5 after the symptom onset, but IgG takes longer to appear on day 14, and they are universally detected on, suppose you test somebody on day 20, most of them will have. That is why it's optimal to collect plasma after 2 weeks, maybe in the 3rd or the 4th week is the best time to collect plasma. As I mentioned earlier, I would like to stress the fact that donor eligibility criteria for regular blood donation should be followed in accordance to the Drugs and Cosmetics Act, which was amended early this year in March 2020. So we all are very familiar as blood bankers, a donor selection form is there. So it's mandatory that they fulfill all those criteria. They also have to fulfill the criteria that I spoke about as defined for selection of plasma donors for convalescent plasma therapy. And that is where testing for COVID-19 initially positive, then two negative tests tested 24 hours apart after 14 days of complete resolution all become very, very important. Now, when we are screening the donors, of course, physical examination is very important, and donors are not fit to donate. If you have a history, a positive history or examination, you're going to exclude them. Those donors who've had recent blood transfusion are definitely going to be deferred. Donors who've had COVID-19 diagnosis more than 4 months prior will also be excluded, because like it was discussed in the previous session, it is known that these antibodies are going to wane away with time. So we are not even sure whether after 4 months after the disease, the antibodies are still going to persist in their circulation. Therefore, it may not be appropriate. So what are the tests that one is going to do? Of course, ABO and RH group is essential and mandatory. It's important to do an antibody screen, a complete blood count, platelet count, hemoglobin, very important, a total and a differential white blood cell count. Donor's hemoglobin should be greater than 12.5, platelet count more than 1.5 lakhs, and total WBC count within normal limits. It's very important to test them for all the transfusion transmissible infections that we are all well aware of, including syphilis and malaria. Test for serum protein. So the plasma protein level should be greater than 6 gram per deciliter. Presence of IgG and IgM antibodies by the appropriate kits that may become available soon. Otherwise, it's important to preserve the plasma and maybe test it subsequently. Now, looking at titration of antibodies, that was also mentioned in the previous session, the desired titers for IgG antibody is 1 in 1024 and for neutralizing antibody, at least 1 in 40. So if not done, like I just mentioned, at the time of plasma collection, we could store the donor sample at minus 80 degrees to be tested subsequently as and when we have test kits available. Another important aspect that we cannot afford to forget is the donor consent. So the donors have to be explained about the procedure, including the adverse events that may be associated, and consenting for donation is absolutely important. Now, moving on to plasma collection. What does plasma collection involve? Of course, any center which decides to conduct this procedure for their patients definitely have to have an apheresis facility, that is a cell separator equipment with adequate space and trained manpower, SOP, the availability of disposable kits, and of course, license for plasmapheresis is very important. So there are several equipments available in the market which can do plasmapheresis as well as plasma exchange. I'm going to be focusing on plasmapheresis. The plasma collection is done by centrifugal separation by any apheresis equipment that may be available in that particular blood bank. The volume collected in each setting should not exceed 500 ml, and this is as per the Drugs and Cosmetics Act. Remember that the extracorporeal volume of blood should not exceed 15% of the total blood volume of that individual. So many of us who are doing apheresis routinely will agree with me that it's mandatory that based on the height and weight of the donor, we calculate the blood volume. And that will help us decide how much blood volume is processed per cycle. And we also ensure that the extracorporeal volume does not exceed 15%. Donor adverse events should be managed as per protocol. Now, how do we store this plasma? The collected plasma can be divided into aliquots. When I told you 500 ml is collected, it can be separated into two 200 ml aliquots and 100 ml aliquot. And where do we store this plasma? At minus 40 degrees Celsius. And remember that as of now, pooling of plasma from different donors is not permitted at this point of time. And by and large, centers opt for this therapy are usually using it as a product as of now, because there is a patient who really requires, there is a donor who is eligible to donate. All that they do is collect and transfuse immediately. So at this point of time, we have not reached a stage where we've been storing plasmas to be used at a later date. We should also remember that what will happen to the antibody titer by repeated freeze-thaw cycle. Now, usually when a plasma is frozen, it can be thawed only once and transfused immediately. So repeat freeze-thaw cycles are definitely not allowed. But even with a single freeze-thaw cycle, is it going to affect the quantity and function of the immunoglobulin is a big question. But as of now, there is no evidence to say that this single freeze-thaw cycle is going to affect the quantity and function of the immunoglobulin. Now, when a donor donates successfully, can he come back to this procedure again? Yes, a donor can come back for repeat procedure at least 2 weeks after the first plasma donation. But we have to ensure that there is no loss of red cells at any point of time. If for some procedural error or some other technical issue, there has been a red cell loss, then the donor will have to be deferred for the next 3 to 4 months, depending on whether the individual is a male or a lady donor, respectively. And as I said, all the donor selection guidelines have to be applied even in the setting of repeat donations. So now in repeat plasmapheresis, it's very important to measure total serum protein and document it. The quantity of plasma separated from the donor should not exceed 500 ml per sitting, and remember that it should not exceed 1000 ml per month. So in effect, he cannot undergo this procedure more than twice a month. Can there be any donor related adverse events? Yes, the donor can have adverse events which are common to any apheresis procedures. They could have local reactions, they could have systemic reactions. It could be mild, it could be severe. So they can be a hypotensive reaction, which is very rare in an apheresis because the volume collected is not very high. Citrate reactions can occur in some individuals. That's why we give calcium for them. Madam explained very well that it can, the procedure can deplete an of calcium. Hematoma formation is quite common. The other complications are quite uncommon. Now, there could be kit or equipment related adverse events. There could be air embolism, leakage, improper mounting of the kit, a common issue, and chances of infection, very, very rare. Now, when we talk about plasma infusion, we have already collected, we have prepared, we have stored. Now, next point is to infuse the plasma. So, this is how the apheresis setup will look. You see the plasma is collected and infused. The clinician will obviously have to send a request for plasma component. What is the difference between a request for a routine plasma and in this setting? He has to specifically mention the diagnosis and he has to specifically ask for convalescent plasma. It's important that we ensure ABO compatibility of the unit, and thawing should happen at 37 degrees and it should be transfused within 2 hours. Standard SOP for transfusion of FFP should be followed, and special care to monitor the patient during transfusion and 24 hours, up to 24 hours post-transfusion is very important. All transfusions must be obviously done using blood transfusion sets. Now, what is the dose that is optimal? There are several studies that have been conducted. We are not yet sure what is the optimal dose. As I mentioned earlier, one dose of 200 ml convalescent plasma is considered the first dose. Now, if this first dose has not led to any adverse event, there could be a second dose that is considered, which can be transfused after 24 hours after the first dose. Therefore, the cumulative dose for each patient becomes 400 ml. Now, when we choose a second, the second plasma unit may be preferably chosen from a different donor depending of availability of another ABO compatible plasma, or else the same donor's plasma could be issued. How do we assess the response to treatment? Of course, clinical evidences are there, radiological evidences are there. There are several other surrogate endpoints. One thing that we could monitor is the antibody titer rise. So the recipient plasma should demonstrate an increase in the antibody titer and a drop in the viral load. Whenever PCR testing is not possible to just monitor response to treatment, one can look at cycle thresholds, value of which will increase when the viral load decreases. There are several variables that are associated with this procedure. As I mentioned, the dose itself is variable. Literature talks about as small a dose of 200 ml and as high a dose of 2400 ml. Antibody titers, you all will agree with me, is very, very variable. Day of transfusion has also ranged from day 6 to even day 50. Viral load decrease has been demonstrated even day 1 after transfusion and even as late as day 30 after transfusion. So a lot of studies are being conducted and a lot more information is coming every day. With every day, a lot more additional information is coming. But these are all some of the variables. We don't clearly have an answer to many of them. I told you about adverse events related to the donor. Do we have adverse events related to the donor? Yes, definitely. Adverse events are possible. But we are glad that most of the time it's medically treatable and non-lethal. But to remember that there are some adverse events associated with plasma, like trali, transfusion associated circulatory overload. You can have a simple allergic reaction. At the same time, In certain rare situations, you can have a severe anaphylactic reaction to plasma proteins. Transfusion transmissible infections, yes, which applies to any other transfusion. Febrile non-hemolytic transfusion reaction are all possible. And this concept of antibody-dependent enhancement has also been talked about. So we've spoken about convalescent plasma as therapy, but in a rare situation, there can be, it can facilitate the viral entry into the individual. But of course, this is as of now only a theoretical concern. It has not been proven in the context of COVID-19 as of today. Yeah, now I just want to draw your attention to an interesting fact. I'm sure many of you have read. What is the association with SARS-CoV-2 infection and blood group? So it has been documented that blood group A individuals are more prone. Okay, so the natural isoagglutinins found in plasma of group O and group B, obviously group B individual will have anti-A antibody. Similarly, group O individuals will have anti-A and anti-B antibody. Now, this naturally occurring anti-A antibody has an effect, has a beneficiary effect. A group individuals have only anti-B antibody and therefore they are more prone to the viral infection. So there is enough literature which talks about it. So I would encourage some of you to go back and look at it more in detail. So it's been shown that the odds ratio of acquiring COVID-19 is higher in blood group A than in blood group O. COVID-19 has more severe clinical presentations in elders and in males. And we all know very well, as one grows older, there is a reduction in the antibody levels. So this could be one contributing factor. So studies are hence ongoing to evaluate the correlation between isoagglutinin titers and outcomes in blood group O and B patients. So while preserving ABO match compatibility, so when I was talking to you earlier, I said it's important to give ABO matched plasma. Blood group O and B donors may be preferred in this context because they have anti-A antibody in the plasma, and also, if possible, to look at the titers of anti-A isoagglutinins. It would be interesting for us to study more about this. So this is just the workflow that we spoke about, the inclusion and exclusion criteria that is involved in the ICMR trial, which involves a control arm and an intervention arm. And the intervention arm is the one that we are talking about, the convalescent plasma therapy, and the control arm where there is a usual standard of care for any COVID-19 patient. And ma'am was just talking about follow-up of these patients. So the study protocol also involves follow-up at day 1, 3, 5, 7, and so on to ensure to monitor the progress of the disease. So what I have essentially talked about is how plasma therapy can help, what is the mechanism of action, how does one select a donor, what is the care that a blood banker has to take? What is the basic infrastructure required? What are the options that are available to us? Is it only apheresis? Can we use component therapy when there is no apheresis facility? And what are the benefits of plasma therapy and plasma exchange in a nutshell? And can the procedure be repeated? How often a donor can donate is all that we discussed about. And my sincere thanks to all of you for the patient hearing. Thanks to the Rajiv Gandhi University of Health Sciences for giving us this opportunity. And thanks to the panel members for sharing this forum with me. Thank you all. Yeah. So I would like to request the delegates who are listening to us now, if there are questions, kindly type it in the chat box, so that if we are able to answer some of them, we could discuss it right now. Thank you.
The multiple signs of COVID-19 is a neutralizing antibody have a uniform efficacy across all strains. No, they because of variations in antigen nature, even the antibodies will not be effective against the neutralizing antibodies. No, the answer is no. Should we check for viral load in plasma donor? No, usually the plasma donor will contain the antibodies and not the viruses. The viral load will be very, very less. There is no viral load at all.
Can I clarify?
Yeah, please.
Yeah. It is, in order to be eligible for plasma donation, it's important to prove that they are RT-PCR negative for COVID-19 on two occasions, 24 hours apart, after minimum 14 days of recovery. So that is one of the required criteria to fulfill. So you must first show that they were PCR, RT-PCR test positive for COVID-19. After 14 days, minimum 14 days period should be there. And you should have two negative tests to be eligible for donation. So that is a required criteria. After administration, what should be the increment in titer of antibody to demonstrate? Yeah, this is a little difficult question to answer. As I told you, there are several variables. Now, as of today, the antibody titer quantification itself is not yet. We are not yet ready for that. There are no commercially available kits as of today. Nor has it been defined what is the minimum antibody, although theoretically it is there. The immune responses of individuals are so different. As I said, the ideal would be to have neutralizing antibody titers greater than 1 in 1048. But we may not, we are yet to evolve. And right now, yes, this antibody titer after recovery, there are not enough studies to say that this should be the minimum increment. This is one of the methods of monitoring the response to patients. Suppose this antibody titer was zero and you are able to demonstrate antibody in the circulation, that itself will reflect that the patient is probably improving. So that is one of the parameters that you could monitor when you respond, when you assess response to therapy.
But however, the ICMR has given a standard titer.
Yeah, not for monitoring. They have only said
for the trial basis. For the trial basis.
Yeah, for recovery, yes. Plasma, plasma pheresis is not available. Just a minute, let me read the question.
Is your question saying not on?
Sir, there was one question there. How much of the treatment decision will be guided by this increment? As of now, as I mentioned, that increment levels itself is not yet optimal, increment is not yet decided. So we cannot, the treatment decision is not based on one factor alone. There are multiple factors which would contribute to the treatment decision. So at this point of time, we don't have that answer ready. So there was another question about, that is not seen, sir. About that plasma.
for that reason only trials are happening in a way.
Yes.
A longer way to fix that one.
Some of the questions are not answered in here. Yes, there is one question saying, is there any chance of residual virus remaining in the plasma? Yes, there is literature to say that there has been viremia demonstrated after more than 1 to 1.5 months. Yes, there is chance. There is also that during recovery that, you know, viral shredding continues to happen. So there is definitely a chance, and that's why it's important for us to test by RT-PCR and demonstrate that it is negative before selecting the donor. Yes. How many cases of, where is that? Is prophylactic, it's jumping. Is prophylactic CP therapy being used in India? Not as I have, we have, none of us have encountered. Yes, in the US.
They are doing it, not here. We are in the phase 1 and phase 2 study.
Is there any chance of residual that we spoke about? How many cases of plasma therapy done in your center till now? Madam, would you want to say anything? In your center, you have
in our center, one
has been done. So, ma'am, you can...
No, you can talk.
Yeah, you can talk.
One study has been done at our center, trial phase 1.
Are there any serological markers to determine need to repeat transfusion, or is it determined by clinical response only? In terms of serological markers for repeat transfusion, as I mentioned earlier, a donor can come for the second donation 15 days after the first donation. And ideally, as of today, we are not yet testing the antibody levels. We are only assuming that he has antibody. He has recovered from the disease. We are proving that they are RT-PCR negative. As of today, antibody tests are not yet in vogue. We hope that the tests will come soon, in which case we will be able to incorporate. That is over. Is there any chance that is also over? How many cases done? That's also over. Yes. Are there any serological markers over? Are viral inactivation techniques being considered for residual viral risk? Yes, there are viral inactivation techniques, definitely. Yes. Like any other plasma product, viral inactivation techniques are definitely an option that we could consider depending on the facilities available at our center, but it's not yet mandatory in India. Am I right?
Yes.
Yeah.
UV rays.
Yeah.
The users.
Yes. Is there a probability of a recipient producing an anti-convalescent serum antibody? Yes. If somebody is recovering from the disease, definitely there is a possibility that the recipient could develop his own antibody. Definitely. So like we saw in the graphic representation that was there in that session, in the normal course, if an individual is recovering from the disease, 14 days in the second week, IgG antibodies start appearing and they peak by third to fourth week, they're well demonstrated. So definitely, yes, recipient, if he's got, if immune system is functional and good and there is an adequate immune response, they are expected to develop their own antibody. So the basic purpose of plasma therapy is that it offers passive immunization to tide over the crisis. So by that time, the recipient or the patient himself starts developing his own antibody. That's why, as I mentioned, it's only a temporary cure. It's a short lasting, unlike immunoglobulins and vaccines, which are going to offer a long-term therapy. Yeah, I hope I've been able to answer this question. Yes.
Yes, sir.
How is the prognosis?
How is the prognosis in plasma-treated patient? Now, the prognosis is multifactorial. Patient with COVID-19 infection may or may not have several other comorbidities. So those are the factors which will influence the prognosis. It's not just by one line of treatment alone that will decide the prognosis. But as I mentioned, one should be very cautious of the adverse events that are specifically associated with plasma therapy. Like I said, the simple allergic response, anaphylactic response in an extreme case, those are risks associated with plasma transfusion. So one should be aware of them, the trolley, the TACO, and all of this should be, one should be careful and watch for them. That is why it's important to monitor these patients during and 24 hours, up to 24 hours post-transfusion, so that we know that there is no adverse event associated with plasma therapy.
It also depends upon what stage this advanced therapy has been implemented, whether it's in the moderate state or in the severe state. If it is in a very severe state, naturally it will become triggered to the other systems to go ahead for the
multi-organ
failure.
So the stage of the disease is another important factor.
An associated disease of the patient also. Is already having the
other comorbidity
suppressive.
So thank you all for the patient hearing. I think sir will
please. Thank you, madam. I'm sure all the participants have benefited. I am standing in for the Honorable Vice Chancellor, who is currently preoccupied with another meeting. I take this opportunity to thank Dr. Srilata, Dr. Harsha, Dr. Anita, and Dr. Sitalakshmi for their wonderful inputs. I am sure in this evolving situation, every bit of knowledge added and every bit of new knowledge that a professional is made aware of will come in handy to handle the situation better. I am sure that all of you who have been a part of this program would go ahead and confidently handle the situation using the knowledge that has been provided. This being the 52nd in the series of training programs conducted by Rajiv Gandhi University of Health Sciences, wherein we have reached out to more than 70,000 attendees. I am sure with the help of professionals as we have with us today, we will be able to take control of the situation and rise to the occasion.